good to see you.
The Subcommittee on Military Construction, Veteran Affairs, and Related Agencies will come to order. Delighted to be here this morning with the first of our appropriations bills this year. Particularly, I think, appropriate that our subcommittee is the first one out of the gate because we have a long-standing tradition of working together and arm-in-arm in a bipartisan way in support of our men and women in uniform to make sure that they have no worries when they are standing on the walls of Rome defending this great nation. Our subcommittee is responsible for making sure that they've got everything they need to for their comfort, for their health care, for their quality of life, both while they are in uniform and when they leave the service and become a veteran. It's also our responsibility to be sure that they have a seamless transition, that they can move into a VA system that can provide them the best possible medical care. And I'm very pleased and proud to also report that our bill this year has dealt with the failure of DOD and VA to develop a single unified medical record in a very straightforward, common sense way, because when they make that transition from being uniform military to VA, you want to obviously be able to access the medical records that followed you in your career in the military ought to go seamlessly and immediately into the VA system. So we've got terrific language in here that will limit the funding of the electronic medical records to 25%, and the agency doesn't get any more until they come to us and can prove both to our committee and the DOD subcommittee that they're actually implementing a plan to create and roll out a single unified medical record. And I want to thank the staff, the Department of Defense the Department of Defense Appropriations Subcommittee has identical language. So I think we've made a huge stride this year in actually forcing these agencies to get off the dime and actually give our men and women a unified medical record. I always remember with horror, Mr. Chairman, your story of the young man who lost eyesight in both eyes because the medical record that he had in the military could not be transferred over to the VA, and that boy lost his sight. And you wonder how many other stories are out there like that. That's not going to happen anymore. We're going to make sure that that is dealt with. We are sending, with this bill, a message to our military that we're going to fund you, that we love you, we support you. We have given our military men and women in uniform all that they've asked for, with a couple of exceptions. We've rescinded some money that was not spent, that the agencies were not able, for example, in some construction accounts to fully justify. We have continued language in the bill this year so that the VA has to use money for construction of hospitals within a five-year period, or they use it or they lose it. They can't just simply keep the money forever and not sign contracts as they had done with the Denver VA hospital that I discovered when I became chairman of this committee. We are also asking for bid savings that have to be reported to all of us. They've got to let us know about any project scope changes. There's aggressive monthly reporting required from each regional office of the VA to give us, as members of Congress, a clear picture of the VA's progress on the disability claims backlog, a huge problem that we're all concerned about, and the VA has got a goal of being able to handle all of those claims by the year 2015 in a timely manner, and we've got bill language in here to help ensure that they reach that target. We, as I've said many times during the course of our hearings, that we want to make sure that our men and women in uniform have no worries when it comes to their housing and also for their families. So we have fully funded the request that the budget Armed Forces gave us for school construction and family housing. But it is especially important, as the debt continues to grow at a just deplorable rate, that we rigorously review all the activities that our government funds. Therefore, we are not funding 10 military construction projects that lack sufficient justification. We've reduced funding for six others, and rescinded $584 million in prior year funding in those accounts, where the agencies had enough money to take care of what they needed, or they couldn't give us sufficient justification. Now, the bill you've got before you was posted yesterday. It's online, as all our bills are. The bill itself is public and has been out on the internet, but and you'll see that the bill includes $73.3 billion in discretionary funding, an increase of $1.4 billion above the fiscal year 2013 enacted level, and $1.4 billion less than the budget request. I know that this is a bill we can all be proud of, members, and I want to thank the members of the subcommittee for the hard work they've done. I particularly want to thank our wonderful staff, both majority and minority, who have just done a superb job. I truly think the Appropriations Committee is the best professional staff on Capitol Hill. They do great work, and we all are very, very grateful to them. Especially want to thank our ranking member, Mr. Bishop of Georgia. It's a privilege to work with you, sir. And we have really had a good time on this subcommittee and making sure that our men and women in uniform are taken care of. And also particularly want to thank you, Chairman Rogers, for the trust you've invested in me and this subcommittee on this extraordinarily important bill that does so much to ease the minds of our men and women in uniform so that they know they have the love, support, and confidence of the United States Congress and their families, and they should never have a worry in the world. We're very fortunate to have you on this subcommittee, Chairman Rogers and Ranking Member Lowy. It's a privilege to work with both of you. Deeply appreciate the support you've given us for our men and women in uniform, and I'd now welcome any comments from our ranking member, Mr. Bishop of Georgia.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, for yielding, and thank you for all of your hard work. As I've said in each hearing, and I'll reemphasize it again today, I believe that sequestration is the wrong way to reduce budgets, and the members of this Congress, both Republicans and Democrat, need to start working together to find a compromise in making fiscally responsible decisions as we deal with our budget reductions. So I hope that as we begin the 2014 appropriation cycle that we can come together to resolve sequestration in a bipartisan fashion and reduce spending in a responsible way that does not undermine our economic recovery. Turning to the bill, Mr. Chairman, on the military construction, I'm pleased that the subcommittee recommendation includes $797 million for the construction or replacement of 17 Department of Defense Education Activity Schools, DODEA. I believe that providing the funds for the Department of Defense Education Activity Schools will not only help our service members' children get quality education in safe, decent facilities, but it will also give our service members one less thing to worry about. Mr. Chairman, I'm also pleased that the subcommittee recommendation includes $151 million for the third increment of the medical center replacement at Landstuhl over in Germany, which is really the key triage point, the evacuation point for our service members who are injured in Iraq and Afghanistan. That includes $151 million, and that seems to be progressing very smoothly. Turning to Veterans Affairs, moving to the Veterans Affairs title, I have to say that I'm very pleased that the mark meets the discretionary budget request in all areas of administrative expenses, research, medical care, information technology, and facilities. I believe that the funding level in this bill will continue to allow veterans to receive outstanding care. However, I, along with the chairman, the ranking member of both the subcommittee and the full committee, have been very, very frustrated with two issues, the claims backlog and the lack of an integrated electronic health record system. We have a serious problem in this country when there are over 850,000 veterans who are awaiting compensation claims. I find it very troubling that we can put a man on the moon, but we can't figure out how to create a joint integrated electronic health record system. Mr. Chairman, on the issue of the claims backlog, it's my hope that fully funding the general operating expenses for the VBA and the Veterans Benefit Management System and the Veterans Claim Intake Program, coupled with the rigorous report requirements that we've put in the bill, will get the claims off paper and lead to digitalization, and it will break through on the backlog. On the issue of electronic records, it's my hope that the language included in the bill that restricts funds for the development of an electronic health record system unless the system meets the requirements of being one single, joint, common, and integrated system that will quickly lead to a unified system that's used by both the Department of Defense and the Department of Veterans Affairs and provides the seamless transition of medical records, which will speed up the claims process by not bringing more paper into the VA. Finally, Mr. Chairman, I'm very pleased that after we met to discuss the bill, that you chose to craft a clean bill, or as we called it in our meeting, a no-drama bill. I believe that your mark, Mr. Chairman, has done a lot of responsible things, and if the bill remains intact, I believe that we will be able to report out a bill with bipartisan support. One last thing that I'd really like to do is to thank the staff for working so hard to get us to this point, although I have to acknowledge that we do have a long way to go. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to our ranking member, Ms. Lowy, and Chairman Mr. Rogers for your leadership and for your commitment to have this committee and the full committee to move forward in a bipartisan fashion toward regular order so that we can get the people's business done. Thank you. Yield back.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bishop. It really is a privilege to work with you and all of you on this subcommittee. Mr. Chairman, it's my privilege to recognize the chairman of the full committee, Mr. Rogers of Kentucky. Thanks,
Thank
sir.
You, Mr. Chairman, for yielding, and I want to congratulate you, Ranking Member Bishop, especially, and the members of the subcommittee for producing a fiscal 14 bill that I think is adequate and difficult under the circumstances, but you've, I think, highlighted the most important aspects of what we should be doing. This is, as you say, the first of the 12 appropriations bills that we intend to mark up in subcommittee and take to the floor of the House. I'm very pleased that this bill is a good example of bipartisan collaboration that addresses the most urgent needs of our nation's veterans. When I first got elected, I told my staff in the district that there's one thing I wanted to do well in my career in the House, and that's to help people with their individual problems with the government. And at the top of that list are veterans. And at the top of that list are disabled veterans. And that this bill, I think, addresses that same concern. Most urgent needs of the veterans, the construction priorities within the Department of Defense. And during this time of difficult fiscal austerity, the subcommittee carefully went line by line, taking difficult but responsible steps to trim excess spending wherever possible and to rescind unobligated balances. And like Mr. Bishop has mentioned, two particular pieces of the bill that I am in total agreement with, especially the electronic medical records requirements of both DOD and Veterans Administration merged into a single system so that no longer will a veteran going to a veterans hospital not be adequately served because VA can't get DOD medical records on that individual. That's inexcusable. And when I first learned about it, I was absolutely aghast, surprised and aghast that these two agencies of the government could not share information, particularly about the lives and health of individual soldiers who had sacrificed on the field of battle with injuries. And we will not tolerate any more that kind of activity, and your bill addresses that, and I appreciate it very much, especially. And then the disability backlog. I think I remember testimony that there's some 800,000 disabled veterans who have not yet had their hearing. That's inexcusable. These are the people that we have sent in harm's way, and they became harmed, and we owe them. And this needs to be cleared up. And I'm glad that your bill includes additional funding, especially for catching up the backlog of disability claims. I thank you especially for that. The bill funds DOD hospitals, clinics, schools, family housing, protects the well-being and health of our veterans by providing medical care, job training programs, education benefits, disability benefits. After our men and women have served their country with honor, it's imperative that we continue to provide these brave men and women with the services they need and deserve, especially the health and disability services. So, Ms. Lowy and I have agreed that this would be the first bill to come out of the chute, and we intend to bring all the bills to the floor of the House as best we can. It's an extremely difficult year fiscally for us. The numbers we're having to deal with are going to make it very difficult to get done what needs to be done. But we're on a path, and this is the lead-off batter, if you will. So I want to congratulate the chairman and the ranking member for a job well done, and thank the subcommittee for good, responsible work. I yield back.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. It's my privilege to represent the ranking member, the gentlelady from New York, Ms. Lowy.
And I want to thank the chair and the ranking member for your bipartisan cooperation and producing a really, really good bill. You can be an example for the rest of the Congress, and I hope you will be. And it is interesting as you look through this bill and you see how important it is that you've been able to agree. And I'm hoping this is the first bill, and I'm hoping others will follow your lead. And I always say it's a pleasure for me to work with the big chairman of the full committee, and I do hope the other committees will follow this outstanding example, and I thank you. This really does represent a good, reasonable approach and continues our long commitment to our veterans and our military facilities. As you know, Mr. Chairman, I have been critical of the House majority's refusal to go to conference to forge a bipartisan agreement on the budget resolution, especially on the 302A allocation. This imperils this year's appropriations process, making it nearly impossible to move all 12 bills. Instead, what I think we will likely see is a few bills given reasonable allocations, while others are left in limbos indefinitely until we pass a CR. Now, Milcom VA, as we mentioned, has received a reasonable allocation that meets the needs of our military and our veterans, and as long as we don't attach any controversial riders, it has a good chance of enactment. Interestingly, the $73.3 billion provided largely mirrors the administration's request and does not reflect sequestration. In fact, the differences between this bill and the administration's requests are relatively small, an adjustment of $1.05 billion due to bid savings and other project adjustments, and the misguided decision not to provide $185 million for the requested 2014 civilian pay raise. Mr. Chairman, if the Milcon VA bill assumes the sequester cuts have been replaced, why can't we assume it was addressed for other bills as well? That is what was presumed by both the administration and the Senate. Turning to individual accounts, I'm pleased the committee is placing more emphasis on our female veterans, both regarding the trauma of sexual assault and the increased need for prosthetics for our female service members. And as you've heard from the chairman, the ranking member, big chairman, we all have been very concerned about the veterans' claims backlogs. And the committee has previously provided the VA with additional resources. And I'm pleased that this bill would hire 94 additional claims processors, provide $155 million for the Veterans Benefit Management System, $136 million for the Veterans Claim Intake Program to significantly speed up claims by converting old paper files into digital files, restrict funds to force the DOD and the VA to have one seamless electronic health record, and Secretary Hagel, as you know, committed to making this decision. We, as long as they coordinate, we're not dictating what system. He committed to do it in 30 days, and that 30 days time frame is almost up. We absolutely need a seamless electronic health record and also require the VA to provide monthly reports. I'm pleased to see you and Chairman Rogers and all of us join together and say we cannot accept any further excuses. The VA must make progress. This is a good bill. I hope we can preserve it through the full committee on the floor. I also hope that my chairman's optimism about sequestration, reflected in the allocation for this first bill, is proven true. And again, I want to thank both chairs, the ranking member, and the outstanding staff of this committee for all your hard work in providing a really good bill. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Will the chairman yield briefly?
Yes, sir.
Point of conversation. We all know this, but it bears repeating. Most of this bill is exempt from sequestration, and that's the reason why you had a fairly good number to mark up to, because most of the bill, and I think 65 or so billion, all the veterans
all
matters,
exempt.
Are exempt from sequestration, which gave you a leg up. I yield back.
Yeah, the only accounts that were subject were the military construction accounts and the cemetery accounts, some of the related agencies, Court of Appeals. But the veterans are well taken care of in this bill, and really is shows the bipartisan nature of this committee and our commitment to our men and women in uniform. The bill is now open for amendments. Does anyone wish to offer any amendments or to be heard on the bill?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Mr. Farr.
I don't have an amendment. I just have an observation that I'd like to share with the committee. I think this is the 16th markup I've been on this committee, and I really appreciate the leadership, joint leadership, and the camaraderie we've had in being able to put this bill together. But what I'm concerned about, and I think it got lost in the policy, is that the military has created a wonderful capital outlay process called the Future Year Development Projects. We call it the FYDP. And I've urged all the other agencies to do the same thing, because it's a self-vetting process that allows the different services to bring their capital outlay projects forward in a five-year period. And what we have done in the past, as some of those projects slip, you know, we funded them last year and then they can't make their deadlines for whatever reasons. And as you stated, we have some money that was left over in that account. In the past, we've allowed other projects that have been on that list, I mean, it's just a waiting period, to come forward because they're ready. And it seems to me we're missing the opportunity to provide construction that is eventually going to be done, but jobs that could be had now, this year. We aren't really changing anything. We're not earmarking anything, because the earmark is essentially done by the services. So that I would really appreciate that that we look at or reconsider the idea that we ought to just rescind that money. We ought to bring those projects forward that are on the FYDP list.
Of course, the challenge is those are geographically specific locations, and until we grapple with and resolve the ban on earmarks, which is something we just simply have to do to exercise. We've got under Article 1, Section 9 of the Constitution, no money can be drawn from the Treasury except by appropriation. And, of course, we are all of us elected because our districts trust our good judgment. And as long as it's a transparent process for an authorized purpose under federal law, I hope that we can get our rules changed so that we can do something like that.
I don't think you need to rule.
That would allow us to move things up on the FIDEP. I tried. In fact, last year when I discovered this great facility in Ohio that does magical work, they were on the FIDEP, but not until 2016. But the work that they're doing is highly relevant right now to what's going on in the world, and we couldn't move it up. So you're exactly right. This is something I hope the Congress will address and resolve.
Will the gentleman yield?
Yes.
Was this a request of a state or local governmental entity?
No. This is the FIDEPs are the services bring them to us. It's their capital outlay list. And what it takes is it's a vetting process that you go through each year. So many meet the threshold, and that's what the president brings in. We find, as the budget year advances, that some of last year's projects couldn't be funded for whatever purpose. And what we've done is allowed other projects that are on that list then to take its place. There's no earmarking here. It's essentially they're going to get funded, and it's not our choice. It's not the Congress member has very little say, and this is
you're right.
The Department of Defense's.
Sam's exactly right. These are projects that have been vetted, approved within the Defense Department. They are on a list of, you know, goes out 5 years, and some of those projects, as you point out, the ones that are near in time, they're not ready. They've got, for whatever reason, they're not all teed up. So in the past, we've been able to say, okay, since you're not ready, let's move down the list and move this one in wherever, Nebraska, up. But because of the ban against a geographically specific location, we can't do it. And it just defies logic and something that we simply have to address. Mr. Bishop, do you have a comment?
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. I think that Mr. Forrest put his finger on a very, very critical opportunity that we have to be more efficient in the way that we go forward with our capital projects. And I think in our bill, and in all of the other agencies, when it comes to construction and capital outlays, I mean, what better way to do it than to have a long-term capital plan? And that's exactly what the FIDEP is with the Department of Defense. And I've been impressed by that since I first learned that there was a FIDEP. And, of course, if every agency did that, at least we could have some priorities that are there. And when there is some circumstance that where the money is not being used as we have directed it, then the others could be moved up the list. It's a very logical, systematic, and efficient way of doing it.
And an important part of our oversight role.
So absolutely.
You're exactly right, Sam, and something we all of us, I hope, will work on together to resolve for the future to make sure we've got that ability to move projects up is a part of our responsibility to make sure our taxpayers' hard-earned dollars are used efficiently.
Gentlemen, it's not an earmark because it may be, I mean, everything that the government funded is going to be spent in some geographical location, but it's not that we are directing a particular location to get it. It's that the agency has established a priority, a need, that happens to be in a particular geographic location, not that we establish it, but
I agree.
It's been done through regular order.
It's a terrible dilemma, and we are restricted by the earmark ban from moving these projects up, even when they're ready and the guys ahead of them are not, because of the earmark ban says no congressionally directed to a geographically specific location. I tried in the Homeland Bill last year to send additional prosecutors, to additional marshals to the southwest border was considered a geographically specific location, and it violated the earmark ban. This just defies logic, something we've absolutely got to fix in our rules. We're obviously going to be good stewards of the taxpayers' hard-earned dollars and use our good judgment in a transparent way. It goes through the full committee process, and I hope we can fix this in the near future. Sam, you bring up a superb point. And our committee in particular, I think, is a glaring, a really important example of the glaring problems that this creates. Judge Carter?
Mr. Chairman, I'd also like to join my friend Mr. Farr and both of you. This is this defies logic as the way the FIDEP works. It took me a while to figure out how the FIDEP worked, and it's a great planning tool. And unfortunately, we have destroyed it with a ruling that I think is incorrect. I don't think moving something up in the FIDEP is an earmark. especially when we have the circumstance that Mr. Farr described. So it needs to be fixed. The military's doing, you know, 21st century planning here, and we're not using it properly.
I intend to share with the members of Congress the one of my hobbies is I'm an amateur astronomer and observe artificial satellites, and I subscribe to these guys around the world that observe artificial satellites, track the orbits of rockets. And I got a map that I will send to each one of you that an amateur prepared that shows that the North Korean intercontinental ballistic missile that they launched, the last one they did in February, it flew directly over the East Coast. They flew it right over Antarctica, and it went right directly over Georgia. It flew right over Virginia, and it's designed to carry a nuclear warhead, and the North Koreans are miniaturizing their nuclear weapons. Anyway, I'm going to share that with the members of the Congress. You can see, and it's a perfect example of the kind of thing. That's a project that's on the FIDEP, but way farther down, tried to move it up, and it was considered an earmark. So thank you, Sam, for bringing this up, and we're going to work on it.
Mr. Chairman.
Any other comments or amendments? Yes, Mr.
Just
Patel.
A brief comment. I want to thank you and the ranking member for the work in this bill relative to traumatic brain injury and post-traumatic stress. One out of six of our veterans face challenges in this area, and through our collective work, we've been focused a little bit on these issues, and I'm very happy that the committee in this mark appropriately recognizes the importance of the VA's work in this, and so I just want to make note of that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I enjoyed working with you on the CJS subcommittee for the research work that's being done there to try to help treat people with traumatic brain injury, because it's often not something you can see or measure, but it's there. So any amendments or further comments? If not, if there's no further discussion, I'd like to at this time recognize Mr. Carter for a motion.
Mr. Chairman, I move the bill be favorably reported to the full committee.
All those in favor will say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, no. The ayes have it. The motion is agreed to. And I would ask unanimous consent that the staff be permitted to make technical and conforming changes to the bill and to report. And without objection, it is so ordered.
Good work.
The subcommittee is adjourned. Thank you.
Congratulations.